Good evening, everybody. Hopefully you can hear me. Thank you very much for joining us this evening. Absolutely delighted to have so many people here for this, the second in our trilogy of science lectures. I don't know about you, but it's definitely turning to autumn and very wet outside here in Edinburgh. So I think it's a great time to be thinking more about our marine environment. So my name's Hannah. I'm coordinating these events on behalf of SAGES. I'll talk a little bit more about that later. But before we begin, I do have a few housekeeping points. I assume that everyone is pretty familiar with Zoom by now, but just to take you through what this evening is going to look like. So this event will begin with a talk by Katie. So if any burning questions come up throughout her talk, please feel free to add them to the Q&A box at the bottom of your Zoom screen. And we'll be using them to grill her at the end. If you have any problems, you can ask for help. There's a chat function at the bottom. So please just reach out to me or any of our panelists and we will do our best to help. Just so you know, if anything goes horribly wrong during this, it will be recorded and made available on the SAGES YouTube channel afterwards, so you're able to revisit it or pass it on to anyone else. So just a little introduction to this evening. It's mainly hosted by two organisations. So SAGES is the Scottish Alliance for Geoscience, Environment and Society, which is why we call it SAGES, which is a pool of researchers from institutions all across Scotland working on a range of environmental and socially relevant topics. Our other organisation is MASTS, the Marine Alliance for Science and Technology, which is again a pool of researchers all with interest in the marine environment. And we've come together to put on what we're calling SeaTember, a month of ocean themed events to engage everyone with our fantastic seas. So this is a partnership held in the run up to COP26, the climate change conference being held in Glasgow in, I think it was about 39 days I saw, there's a countdown clock. So these events are really all about the excitement and challenges of finding scientific solutions to climate change. And the event series we've put on over this year really spans the globe from the Arctic to the Antarctic, trying to engage everyone with scientific research going on today. And if you would like to find out about future events, we have one more talk in the trilogy and a talk in October. Please sign up on the mailing list link I will put in the chat shortly. So I'm really excited to bring you this, the second of our short SeaTember lectures. And the format will be a short talk on marine nature-based solutions called What Has the Sea Ever Done for Us? So for this event that's incredibly relevant to a lot of people and to what the conversations will be at COP, I'm really delighted to introduce Katie Gilham, who is the head of coastal ecosystems at NatureScot. Now, I hope she won't mind me saying that Katie has been with NatureScot for, I think, over 20 years, is that right? Beginning as a marine area officer and now in charge of the marine unit, specialising a lot of the exciting work around our marine environment, including the protected area network. So I'm really excited to have her join us and tell us more about why our marine environment, particularly in Scotland, is going to be so vital to discussions that are coming up at COP26. So Katie, I'll hand over to you.
Thanks very much, Hannah, and thanks very much for the invite for speaking this evening. It's really nice to be able to speak to quite a different audience, I think, from a lot of the people that I spend my day job talking to. When I share the presentation, I'll disappear from the screen. So I just wanted to say hello first, and then I'll just start sharing that presentation just now. So if you bear with me a minute. And hopefully that's coming through to you now. So as Hannah said, this presentation is called What Has the Sea Ever Done for Us? And I was trying to really think as I was putting this presentation together, what it was that really made me enthusiastic about becoming a marine biologist and really inspired me to get involved in marine conservation work. So I went back to some of my old diving photos and I pulled out this photo, which is in the bottom of the slide here, when that must have been one of my first wreck dives that I did about 30 years ago. Unfortunately, what I didn't have was any photos from my very first ever shore dive that I did. And I just wanted to say a little bit about that because it had a big impact on me. So about 10 minutes before the end of the dive, we found a little sandy patch in quite shallow water and noticed a couple of cuttlefish just swimming around. So my dive instructor just said, right, let's just settle here and see what happens. So we settled on the seabed, and within a couple of minutes, I had between sort of 7 and 10 cuttlefish swimming all around me, some just exploring around my head, some swimming underneath my arms. And it was just a really kind of exciting, inspiring experience to have had. And I just remember coming to the surface and trying to explain it to people, and the nearest thing that I could try and explain it as was like being in the middle of a David Attenborough documentary. So I think that's really what kind of started me on this journey. What I'm going to talk about for this talk, I'm going to give a brief introduction to some of what makes Scot and Sea so special, and say a little bit about what NatureScot does, so the organisation that I work for, and some of the evidence that we have at the moment about the state of Scot and Seas. And then in the rest of the talk, what I'll do is just kind of go through and give some examples of a range of different projects, some of which I'm directly involved with, some of which colleagues are involved with, but all of which are kind of big collaborations with other organisations, coastal communities, and a wide range of stakeholders. So looking at Scot and Seas first, so I think people will be aware Scotland is near the edge of the European continental shelf, and the area of Scot and Seas is actually equivalent to about 6 times the area of land that we have in Scotland, and the coastline is really complex. This has a huge influence on the marine life that we see in our seas. So we've got the big firths such as the Moray Firth, Firth of Forth, Solway Firth, and all the sea lochs down the west coast, as well as over 900 different islands. And although everyone will be most familiar with seeing the shallow waters close to their nearest beaches or looking out from cliffs, when you go really right off the edge of the continental shelves into some of the deepest troughs, you can get waters down to about 2,500 metres. On this slide, it shows some of the benefits that we get from Scot and Seas at the moment, and I'm not going to talk about all of them just now, but I'll highlight a couple and I'll come back to these in a bit. In terms of the benefits, there's things that people really enjoy and get a lot from in terms of wildlife watching, as I mentioned just before, tourism and recreation. There's all the healthy fish stocks and shellfish stocks that we rely on, and energy, which obviously people will be aware of is changing hugely at the moment, where we've had a traditional reliance on oil and gas, but where renewable energy is increasingly becoming part of the mix. So we can't fit everything onto this slide in this one diagram, but hopefully it gives you an idea of some of the kind of wide range of benefits that we get from Scot and Seas. And alongside that, I just wanted to highlight some of the things that are really of international importance in terms of our habitats and wildlife. So on the top right hand corner, there's a photo there from the NOS National Nature Reserve up in Shetland, representing our internationally important breeding seabird colonies. And then if we shift over to the left hand side there, we've got the bottlenose dolphins associated with the East Coast, and particularly with the Moray Firth. And they're the most northerly population of bottlenose dolphins that we have. The last one I was just going to highlight is the flame shell in the bottom left hand corner, and I think it's probably quite obvious why it's called a flame shell, and there are flame shell beds in various locations down the west coast, we think that we've probably got the largest flame shell beds in the world in Scotland. So over the next couple of slides, I'll just cover a bit about what NatureScot does. So essentially, we're Scotland's nature agency. That means that we provide advice to Scottish Government about our natural environment. And we also have a responsibility to inspire people about it. A lot of our work at the moment is focused around biodiversity loss and the climate emergency. And we've got 3 main strands to that work. So there's leading nature's revival, sustaining nature's resources, and growing nature's value. And the reason why I've highlighted the top bullet there in blue is because that's what I'm going to focus on in most of the rest of this talk, because I think that's where it's really relevant to a lot of the work going on right now on marine and coastal side of things relating to climate change. it's very difficult to summarise a large amount of work that lots of different people are involved with, but on this slide I've just tried to give a flavour of some of the marine work that NatureScot does. So we provide a lot of advice to other people, whether that's developers or government regulators. So provide advice on things like offshore wind farms, marine planning, marine protected areas, trying to achieve sustainable fisheries. And there's a whole range of marine habitat and wildlife specialists that work in the teams at NatureScot. We also get involved in on the ground work as well. So you'll see there's a picture there of one of my colleagues counting things underwater whilst they're diving. But we also equally have people who are out there counting things like this puffin on the seabird colonies. And I'm just going to move now to talk about a little bit on the evidence of what we know of the state of Scotland's seas. One of the projects that I've been involved with over the last few years was called Scotland's Marine Assessment 2020, and that was led by Marine Scotland. And essentially what we were trying to do was bring together all the most up-to-date information about Scotland's seas so that we could really understand what changes are happening, what the status is of various different aspects, and in this case, habitats and species. So this diagram just tries to summarise that. The species that are on the left-hand side, which are shown in green, are the ones where we have fewer concerns. And those that are over on the right-hand side are the ones that have more concerns. And particularly at the moment, we're concerned about the state of seabed habitats, changes that we're seeing in relation to plankton communities. So plankton are the small animals that will live in the water and that largely are kind of moved by ocean currents rather than moving by themselves. And then also we've got salmon and sea trout populations there. And if anyone's wondering what's below the grey line, these were all the things that we did assessments for, but actually there wasn't enough data to properly assess status and trends. So they're still areas that we need to do more work on in the future. And if you want to find out anything more about these assessments, they're all available on the Scotland's Marine Assessment portal. Some of the other key messages that came through, which were kind of slightly broader than the assessments on habitat species, were about the marine economy and its importance. So I find it quite difficult to get my head around numbers this big, but £14.66 billion worth. The highlight was also around marine industries that are really showing a lot of growth at the moment, such as offshore wind and marine tourism. And the assessment also looked at what are the current pressures on the marine environment that we really need to think hard about. So climate change was flagged as one of those, ocean acidification as well, which is the changes that are caused to the pH of the oceans as a result of absorbing the carbon dioxide that we're putting into the atmosphere. And also pressures associated with bottom contacting and pelagic fishing gears as well. There was also highlights relating to marine protected areas and marine litter, and saying that, you know, there's a lot of work that's being done, but these are relatively new areas and they still need more time to be fully effective. The last piece of evidence that I was going to touch on in this talk comes from the Marine Climate Change Impacts Partnership. And so we're a partner in this work, and it's a really good initiative which takes recent science publications and then turns them into relatively user-friendly report cards that then can be used by a range of different audiences, including by government policymakers. And I've highlighted some of the things from the most recent report card that was done in 2020, which was really highlighting messages that you already have heard in the media, really, about climate change is happening now. It's not something that we can think about into the future. And through warming seas and reduced oxygenation, ocean acidification, all of those things together, we're seeing changes and impacts already. There's also an increased coastal flood risk that is associated with the rising sea levels, and we are seeing impacts already on fisheries productivity, and partly that can be explained by historic overexploitation, but actually ocean warming is also having an impact as well. That all feels quite stark, a lot of that, in terms of the evidence on the state of Scotland's seas, but I also wanted to bring in this diagram, which is from a publication that focused on looking at the trends that have been happening with terrestrial wildlife, but I think it's quite good in sort of setting out what the options could look like. So the black line at the top is really meant to document these are the changes and the loss that we've seen in habitats and species on land. And then the other lines give us those options. So we could continue down the grey line if we just have a business as usual approach. Or if we go to the orange line where we increase our conservation efforts, we can see the results there. But actually there's another option as well, which is the green line, which is the increased conservation efforts. Plus actually really thinking hard about the way that we produce all of the things that we use, particularly the way that we produce our food, and also thinking really hard about how we all as individuals act as consumers and making sure that we're consuming things sustainably. So I think it's quite a nice illustration of those different options and alternatives that we can start to think through. Feels like I've gone quite a long way through the talk without actually saying what a nature-based solution is, and there's lots of different definitions and discussion about what it is. The definition that I've put up here is from the International Union for Nature Conservation, and essentially it's saying that nature-based solutions are ways of working with natural and modified ecosystems to address multiple societal challenges. So we're thinking about different actions that not only have a biodiversity benefit but can also have wider societal benefits as well. So that might be in relation to flood risks or other natural hazards. It might be in relation to food production or the availability of clean water and green space. So there's a whole range of different options, but essentially working through a nature-based solutions approach should ultimately lead us to having biodiversity benefits as well as benefits for human well-being. I'm going to just run through a few examples of how some of these things are starting to be put into practice. And the first one of these is around coastal adaptation and resilience. And essentially the focus of this approach is really around restoring natural processes to make sure that habitats can function in a natural way. And in some cases, then to perform functions that they maybe have lost through past management. And the idea is that this maximises the ability of habitats to respond to and adapt to sea levels as they rise. So you can see the picture on the top right hand screen shows a hard defence with a seawall there. And underneath you've got what we would call sort of soft engineering with a sand dune habitat. And some of the work that's been done through the Dynamic Coast Project in Scotland has shown that about 80% of our built assets, and by that I mean things like our roads, our railways, people's houses and other buildings, are protected by these natural defences, with only about 20% being found behind the man-made ones. And I've got a couple of examples of some contrasting approaches here. So in St Andrews about 10 years ago, there were real concerns about the erosion that was being caused associated with a particularly big storm, but actually then concerns about what that would mean into the future. And so what was identified was areas where sand was accreting, so actually there was more sand building up naturally, and using that sand to actually replenish the shoreline that was vulnerable to erosion. And protecting that. And then there's also the example at Nigg Bay in the Cromarty Firth, which was an approach of coastal realignment, where the RSPB led a project essentially to allow seawater back into an area and recreate a salt marsh habitat. And so the idea being that essentially as the natural processes are restored and the habitat can begin to function again, as sea levels rise, it can actually provide a protective buffer zone as water would otherwise have inundated other areas and caused flooding problems. There's also quite a lot of interest in restoring marine habitats at the moment. And while most of the focus of marine management is really about reducing the pressures that I'd mentioned previously on the marine environment, there's two particular things that people are really interested in from a restoration perspective. And that's native oysters and seagrass beds. And I'll just say a little bit about seagrass beds now. So they are really important habitats. They grow in very shallow coastal waters. They can grow in either very kind of muddy areas or sandy areas. There's quite a range there. And the reason why they're important is because they can provide food and shelter as well as nursery areas to a range of other species. And they can also act to stabilize sediments. And I'll come on to say a bit more about blue carbon in a minute, but that's quite relevant here. There's been quite a lot of focus on seagrass from a conservation perspective. They're recognised as priority marine features, so they're priorities for focusing conservation action in Scotland, and they're also included in marine protected areas. So I think about 20 MPAs they're included in. And increasingly, people are interested in looking at what more we could do to help this species. So on the East Coast, what you tend to have is these kind of larger, more extensive beds in the sheltered firths. But on the West Coast, there's much more scattered, smaller beds, which reflect the kind of complex coastline. And that's where there's been a lot more interest from community groups and NGOs such as Project Seagrass in trialling methods to actually restore. So there's places like Loch Craignish, for example, where there are community-led restoration projects going on at the moment. And we're really interested to see how that's developing. And in terms of NatureScot's role and the support that we provide, we're trying to provide support and interpretation around the methods that can be used and trying to help people to sort of think through all of the different areas that they need in the project development around a restoration project. So it's quite an exciting area of work at the moment. I mentioned when I was talking about seagrasses, about blue carbon as well. Probably people will be more familiar with work and reference in relation to restoring peatlands on land. And there's been a lot of talk about making sure that the carbon that's contained in peatlands is kept in those peatlands and isn't getting released back into the atmosphere. And so the evidence that we have at the moment is that the carbon that's stored in the sediments, so that's the sands and the muds on the seabed, are at least as important as the peatlands that are present on land. And there's a large programme of research that's underway to try and understand more about that. So there's the Scottish Blue Carbon Forum that's running the Blue Carbon Research Programme to really understand more about what this means for marine habitats. And there's a range of different things, as well as the sediments that I mentioned before. There's kelp forests and all the carbon that's stored in there. But there's also a huge amount of core carbon that's stored in the phytoplankton as well. So that's also of interest. And there's really key questions that we're quite early stages yet at thinking how best do we manage these marine habitats in terms of making sure that the carbon that's there stays there, but also to encourage the storage of more carbon in the future. And the last example of current work that I was going to talk about is the Scottish MPA network. It's probably the area that I've been most involved with out of all the things that I've touched on in the presentation today. Essentially, we have a whole range of different marine protected areas that have now been set up around Scotland. Some of those are international designations or European designations or domestic designations as well. And those ones are largely shown in purple on this map here. One that I wanted to pay particular attention to, there's a small green square around Fair Isle, which you can see between Orkney and Shetland over on the right hand side of the diagram. And this is a really interesting area. It was proposed by the community of Fair Isle as a demonstration and research MPA. And the thing that they're really keen to demonstrate about this area is how can you sustainably manage a local marine area in collaboration between an island community and all of the statutory organisations and other stakeholders that want to use that area or have responsibility for managing it. Because Fair Isle, you know, obviously sees the marine environment as fundamental to its continued sort of thriving as an island community, particularly because of the reliance on the tourism, which is reliant itself on the marine environment and healthy seabird populations. So I think that's a really interesting example to watch. And where we've got to with marine protected areas so far, we've got over 230 of them now set up, with the last ones being designated most recently at the end of last year, covering more than a third of Scotland's seas. So they're really covering quite a substantial area. And we've got management measures in place to protect the most sensitive habitats. So on the left here, I've got a picture of merle beds. So that's the pink sort of twiglet looking habitat there, which is a very slow going species, pretty fragile. It only grows at about 1 to 2 millimetres a year and is very, very important in Scotland's marine environment. And then above that, one of the other species that we've put management measures in place for is the flapper skate, which we've got an MPA for in Argyll. Alongside the existing work, government has already committed to putting more fisheries management measures in place for existing MPAs, and on top of that, protecting an additional 10% of Scotland seas as highly protected marine areas. And that work's yet to start, but it's obviously going to be a big part of the work going forward over the next few years. And I think it really provides us with an opportunity to think about what we want our MPAs to do, and to really think through. MPAs have been set up obviously to protect the habitats, the wildlife, sometimes for geological features as well. What else can they do, and what wider benefits can they bring? And there's things that we've been starting to explore through, for example, one of the projects that we're involved in, which is an Interreg funded project called MARPAM, which is the Marine Protected Areas Monitoring and Management Project, which is a bit of a mouthful, and we're focusing on working with stakeholders in the Outer Hebrides and Argyll at the moment through that. So really, just to kind of close the presentation part of this evening, you know, Scotland seas are hugely diverse in terms of the actual environment itself, but also the range of marine wildlife and habitats that are supported. And there's been a lot of work that's been going for many years, and quite a lot of progress has obviously been made in the conservation side of things as well. But I think it's fair to say that now, with a focus on biodiversity loss and the climate emergency, that's really increased the focus and changed it as well. So we've talked for many years about conservation and management, but we're now talking much more about how do we build resilience for habitats and wildlife, and how do we support them to adapt better to the changes that we know that are coming. And I think with nature-based solutions, what we have is really an opportunity to join up across all these different challenges that society will be facing in the future. So we're not just thinking about biodiversity loss, but actually how does work that we're doing for biodiversity contribute to wider societal challenges? And actually, it's more than that. How can we design the work that we're doing so that it delivers those wider benefits and not just for biodiversity? And then the very last slide that I wanted to finish on was really just a slightly different take. I think it's been, you know, well recognised for a number of years that the quality of the green spaces that people and communities can access is really important in terms of the health and well-being of those communities and individuals. And there's really started in the last few years to be much more of a focus on, well, what does that mean for the sea, and does the same kind of benefit come through? And we're starting to see more articles published and papers, which I've just taken a few screen grabs of and shown here, which are about the benefits of sea swimming, just as one example. But I think increasingly we'll be thinking about people's relationship with the sea, not just in terms of the economic relationship or the cultural relationship, but also about the well-being side of things. And I think then alongside thinking about the relationship between biodiversity loss and climate change, we'll be thinking about how the work that we do for all of that actually also addresses the health issues that we see that are happening in the world today. So that's it for the presentation, and I'll stop sharing my screen and then hand back over to Hannah, I think.
Thanks, Katie, so much. That was, I think, a brilliant kind of introduction to so many different topics, particularly what's happening in Scotland at the moment, which is very exciting. It's certainly nice to see all these things. So I've got a few questions coming through already. You've still got plenty of time to add it in if you are listening and want the opportunity to hear Katie's thoughts on things. But I sort of start off a little bit by picking up on your last point, I guess, because I know some people have said to me that the term nature-based solutions maybe feels like it's just a follow-on from ecosystem services, which is a follow-on from valuing the environment. And I think some people see that there's a potential difficulty with this idea of trying to put a value on what nature does for us versus a movement which is about people seeing themselves as very much more as part of nature and for its own intrinsic value. So I wonder if you could maybe comment on what your thoughts are around that, and if you think there is a disconnect, or can they be both at the same time?
Yeah, I think there's been quite a change in people's perception of what that term nature-based solutions means over the last while. And I think when it was first being used, there was definitely a feeling that it was using nature-based solutions to achieve things for nature. And I think that one of the reasons why I really like that IUCN definition that I referred to, it's really making us think much harder, and it's using nature-based solutions for a much wider range of societal problems and challenges that exist. So I think if we don't do that, we're much more likely to end up with the disconnects that you're referring to in terms of people seeing that flooding can be dealt with in one way, or that you can build a seawall and that will help with a coastal erosion problem. But if you actually start to look from the perspective of what do we want to achieve in individual places? And I think this is where it starts to, without using too much jargon, where it starts to come into looking at the place-based approaches for developing different areas as well. Once you start to look about what you want to achieve more broadly in a place and how you join that up, you can start to think, and it refers back to the title of the talk about, you know, what have the seas ever done for us, or what more could they do for us in the future, and how do we collectively work to achieve that?
Great. I think that's a nice answer to a difficult question. And it's interesting you bringing up place-based approach, which again, I think is a word that's kind of, or a term that's developing, that is really coming out. And you mentioned a little bit about some of the community-led work that's happening around seagrass restoration and maybe the MPAs. I wonder if you could talk a little bit more about this kind of new focus on, maybe not that new, but particularly for Scotland, this focus on community-led approach and that place-based approach versus your role in NatureScot, and how these two can combine powerfully to provide some solutions.
Yeah, it's a really interesting area, and I think, you know, there's been lots of work done over a number of years where, well, it's very rare actually for organisations to work in isolation now. Most of the work that various different organisations, whether you're government or not, that you do, you're involved with a whole range of different partners. And I think one of the nice things about my work over the last 10 years is there's been a kind of an increasing level of engagement with communities through NatureScot. And that, I guess, took a step change when we were originally talking about the first nature conservation MPA designations in the kind of early 2010s. And what was really nice about that work is, prior to that, we had largely been through processes of site selection, where we'd said to people, well, you know, this is where we think your MPA should be. This is the evidence for it. And this is kind of, you know, we're asking you what you think about that. And that was part of this process. But we also had a process which was about third-party proposals. And so there are a number of different organisations and communities who came forward and said, well, this is where we want our MPA to be. And this is what we, this is the reasons why, and can this be considered? And a number of those MPAs that were put forward at that time then went on to be designated by Scottish ministers as well. So I think that was really nice. And also what had happened as a result of that, beyond it being kind of, you know, great to get the recognition of those environments and how important the local communities felt that they were, what's happened then is that those communities have stayed really engaged in the management of those areas, because they've had a stake in managing them and in setting them up. And so we then find that there are a lot of communities that were really interested in getting involved in the monitoring, understanding more about the condition of those areas, and then obviously getting involved in the management side of things. So one of the other projects that we've been running more recently is a real mouthful, so I'll take it slowly, but it's the community-led marine biodiversity monitoring project, and that's been funded by the William Grant Foundation. Essentially, we've had a member of staff who's been working with local community groups who are part of a wider coastal communities network in Scotland, to identify kind of various different training needs that they might have in terms of different techniques, and also to provide guidance and to provide funding to enable those communities to buy various different pieces of equipment. And it's really nice to see the communities kind of take those things on board and get set up and actually starting to produce really good data about what's happening in their local areas. And I see that as a really nice kind of complement to the work that NatureScot's involved with. You know, we've got a relatively discrete survey team, and we target a number of marine protected areas each year in order to find out more about their status. But these community groups are achieving far more in terms of the number of MPAs and the amount of repeat survey works that can happen than we can ever do. So I think it's just having a really nice kind of reciprocation at the moment. And I guess the next stage for a lot of community groups is then sort of how does that play out in terms of the longer term and the benefits and the management side of things.
Yeah, that's great. I've been involved in the community monitoring, and I think it's a fantastic scheme that's just going to build over time as well, which is great to kind of keep that capacity ongoing. You mentioned management there, and I think, you know, obviously you touched on it in your talk, but it's when it comes to marine protected areas, I think maybe some people are a little uncertain about what that actually means in terms of what's allowed in there and how they're managed. And you said, I think 10% are going to become highly protected. Can you talk a little bit about what marine protected areas actually mean in terms of what's allowed to be done there, and how is that progressing in the future?
Yeah, okay. And you're right, there are often lots of questions around this area. With the marine protected areas that we have in place at the moment, largely what happens is that they'll be set up to protect particular habitats or particular wildlife. So things that I mentioned in the talk, it might be a flame shell bed, it might be a mull bed or a pod of bottlenose dolphins in the Moray Firth, for example. And then we look at those habitats or those species and try to understand what we think their status is. So if we think that they are in a good condition and the focus needs to be on conserving them, or whether we think that actually there's been damage that's happened in the past and there's a need for them to recover or to, in some cases, to be restored. And so we then go through a process which sounds quite technical of setting conservation objectives. And then all of the management that comes through really sort of flows from that, and having a really good understanding of what the sensitivity of those different features are. So on the seagrass slide, I'd highlighted some of the sensitivities to seagrasses there, which was to things like pollution, to things like physical disturbance, for example, sometimes to invasive non-native species or to any kinds of coastal development that affect water flows and the hydrodynamics around the seagrass beds. So if we have a clear set of conservation objectives and an understanding of the sensitivity of the features, we can then have a conversation about the different activities that are happening in a marine protected area, whether there's a need to change any of those or restrict any of them, or whether those activities can continue. And a lot of the MPAs that we've got at the moment, a lot of the activities really continue as they did before. And there are you know, some MPAs that are for really, really sensitive features, for things like the circular reefs that are found in Loch Criwen, for example, where, you know, there'll be then quite strict management measures in relation to anything that might actually damage those reefs, which are really quite vulnerable to the colonies collapsing. But in other areas where we'd say, for example, have a large expanse of burrowed mud habitat, and I think burrowed mud is a fantastic and very undervalued habitat, but it doesn't need to have the same levels of protection put in place as a circular worm reef would need to have. And so the management is then designed accordingly to that. So the kinds of management that's being put in place for those burrowed mud habitats is to reduce fishing pressure, for example, by stating what, you know, that only smaller boats can go into those areas. So there's actually less fishing effort that's actually happening in them. So there's a whole range of different approaches for the existing MPAs. Coming on to what you're asking about the highly protected marine areas, the policy on that really still needs to be developed. So, you know, this is all to come in the next year or so. But essentially, there are various different definitions of highly protected marine areas, but they're really focused on a much stricter level of protection than we currently have, and thinking about how you set up areas that actually really are really very resilient, and that activities that are considered to be extractive or destructive then wouldn't take place within them. So that's the main aim of those, and we really need to think about what does that mean in Scotland, what does it look like. But I also think the important point about highly protected marine areas is again just going on to that slightly broader look, and thinking that there are lots of things that other stakeholders want to achieve in the marine environment. So for example, from a fishing industry perspective, if they're wanting to protect nursery areas or spawning grounds, at the moment those areas are protected using fisheries legislation, and it still means that anyone else can do whatever they want in those areas largely. But for example, if there's a desire from the fishing industry to have some of those areas really highly protected from all activities, you know, that could be a really interesting area to start exploring in terms of being good for the environment, but also having a wider sort of socioeconomic benefit too.
So I guess following on from that point, adding another level of questioning onto that, we've had a couple of questions through about, I guess, things like MPAs and their role in climate change. So in particular in storing carbon, you mentioned blue carbon. And are there particular areas of marine habitat that are important for storing carbon? And then as a follow on from that, if that's the case, does that influence decisions are related to the need for MPA measures? Like, is there an element of carbon accounting in there to justify the need to take action? I guess there's another decision-making tool that's been thrown in here. So maybe you could talk about how that's now playing out.
Yeah, so there's definitely, you know, differences in the amount of carbon that are stored in different habitats, and we're starting to get a good handle on that. And I was mentioning some of those things in terms of what's stored in burrowed mud, what's, you know, in seabed sediments, what's stored in kelp forests as well. So we're starting to get a better handle on those. There are lots of different opinions about MPAs and blue carbon, and where I tend to sit on that is that I think it's quite a popular thing to say that we'll have MPAs for blue carbon, and there's sort of two thoughts I have in relation to that. A lot of the marine protected areas that we have set up, you know, cover habitats that are really important for blue carbon already. So things like burrowed mud, things like, you know, many of the kind of shellfish beds that have been set up as well. So they're already covered, and a lot of the management that we've put in place to protect those habitats is likely also to be very good for blue carbon. I think the bigger questions around blue carbon and where that can possibly achieve greater benefit is actually thinking about what's actually happening in the wider seas and what's our kind of wider approach to management. One of the things that I'd mentioned from Scotland's Marine Assessment 2020 was recognising that you know, bottom contacting fishing is still one of the most widespread direct pressures that we exert as a society on our seas. And that's very closely related, obviously, to what's happening with the blue carbon that's stored in our sediments. And so I think having a discussion about how questions around blue carbon are integrated into sustainable fisheries is a really important part of the question, rather than restricting the question to within marine protected areas per se, although it, you know, it's obviously relevant to that. So yeah, I think that's a really interesting discussion, but the research is quite early stages. And I know there have been calls by some people to say, well, look, if they're habitats that are storing blue carbon, then we shouldn't be fishing on them. I think the real answer is probably more complicated than that. And we're likely to see, as the research comes through, that there are different thresholds, and so up to a certain level of fishing you will still see blue carbon stored, and you will still see additional blue carbon being sequestered into the sands and the muds and the other habitats there, and it's about understanding what level we can go to before that tips over into actually damaging those blue carbon stores. Did that answer both parts of your question?
I did, yes, and thank you. That was a good answer to a multi-part question. And I think, you know, that message of, I think people maybe underestimate how little we understand about all these different interactions, particularly in the marine environment. Despite how much work has been done and how much we have advanced that understanding, it is still so much more to go. So I guess a follow-on from that then is, someone was asking about, obviously you're talking about Scotland, NatureScot, and our seas around here, but how important to our marine health are other areas? So obviously we're very interconnected ocean systems. Are there things that other countries are doing that are impacting, or kind of wider ocean problems that are impacting on Scottish marine health? And are things like designations in other areas going to help or hinder our efforts in Scotland?
Yeah, I mean, I guess one of the slides that I had toyed with putting in, which I decided not to in the end because I just didn't have enough time to talk through it all, was one of the other slides that came from Scotland's Marine Assessment 2020. And it was a food web illustration that we had drawn, and really showing the importance of all the connections in the marine environment. It was drawn as quite a small scale, so you can imagine, you know, the seabirds flying along and feeding on the forage fish. You've also then got kind of close to the seabed, you've got cod feeding on things like, you know, the nephrops or scampi on the burrowed mud habitats. You've got the nursery areas provided then by things like the seagrass and kelp forests. And so you've got this whole kind of continual connections. And I think the debate on land about connectivity is how can we reintroduce connectivity between different terrestrial habitats, whereas in the sea I think it's quite different. We just have to recognize that, you know, whatever we do, there's going to be connectivity there, and we just have to understand it and work with it. So I guess that was on quite a small scale, but it was intended to illustrate that there are these larger connections that are happening. And at a very large scale, I guess if we're talking about climate change, there's long been discussions about the amount of fresh water that's actually now entering from glaciers into the sea, and what effect that's going to have on ocean circulation, both because of the temperature of the water and its salinity or lack of salinity, and at the kind of really kind of grand scale, and not to be too doom and gloom about it, but whether that starts to turn off the you know, the really kind of global circulations that we're seeing, and particularly for Scotland, what would be important about that is then actually turning off the slope current, which is I guess what people would more commonly have referred to previously as the Gulf Stream, which is bringing lots of warmer waters up to Scotland, and whether our climate becomes more like Newfoundland in the future. So there are definitely those kind of bigger changes that you know, Scotland definitely has a role to play in terms of meeting its climate change commitments and getting towards net zero, but it relies in avoiding those really big impacts, it relies on that collective action. I guess that's part of the reason why we're having this series of talks leading up to the COP, and the reason why we're all pinning so much hope on the discussions that are going to take part as the COP, because however much we do as individual countries, it won't be enough to actually tackle the problem that needs to be tackled on a global scale.
I have another question following from that, but someone was just asking, and maybe this is a nice place to put it in, do you have hopes for COP? What is your kind of reaction to what's going to happen at COP? Do you think it's going to make a difference? Do you think this is going to be a watershed moment in a positive way, particularly for our marine environment?
Yeah, I hope so. And I think there's an increasing recognition of marine work. I don't think marine work has ever been so prominent. You kindly pointed out that I've been working in conservation for 20 years. And I've never seen, you know, international politicians talk so much and you know, to give so much attention to marine sort of related issues. So I'm hopeful from that perspective. And I guess looking back to things that were kind of, you know, very difficult at the time, but reaching the Paris Agreement, you know, that really was a landmark agreement, and it signalled a huge change in kind of what government's aspirations were. And I think you have to be hopeful that at this next COP, it's the next stage on, and that people then are more serious about, well, we made these previous agreements, and how can we collectively get closer to achieving them to make sure that we avoid the worst impacts that could be associated with climate change.
It's nice to have a little bit of hope at these talks. I feel like sometimes if you work in conservation for 20 years, it's very easy to become depressed. So it's nice to know that you still have hope. I guess an interesting point then, because we're talking about international collaboration, is where is Scotland compared to others, particularly marine conservation? You know, are we leading the way? Are there others that we should be looking to take inspiration from our next steps?
Yeah, I mean, I think you can always learn from others, definitely. So that's always got to be part of the approach there. In terms of what Scotland has achieved so far, I think Scotland is right up there in terms of the progress that it's made on marine protected areas, in terms of the research work that's going on into things like blue carbon, and actually through projects like Dynamic Coast, which I mentioned earlier in the talk, actually the whole kind of change in the government conversation around the need to actually work with natural processes and to think about coastal adaptation and resilience, which then, you know, 20 years ago that might have been seen as kind of slightly fringe approach to doing things, but it's now really, you know, securely part of the mainstream. And I guess my my main direct experience of international work is I kind of periodically get involved with discussions as part of the OSPAR convention, which covers conservation in the Northeast Atlantic. I think there's been some really good examples of where we've done sort of joint work. So for example, one of my colleagues in that group is from Sweden, and they produced some really great materials on the restoration of seagrasses, and you know, really good technical stuff. They're kind of research and expertise was beyond what we commonly had in Scotland, but people in Scotland were finding it difficult to access it because it was obviously all written in Swedish. So it was a very simple thing that we did, but we then worked with the authors, paid for the work to be translated, made sure they were happy with it, and that guidance is now being made available to inform other people in Scotland about what's going on. So I definitely think there's a lot more to come from those kind of international cooperations, and that's a very, very small example, I'm aware of it, but I think it's a kind of practical example of where, kind of, for not very much input, you can really start to make quite a lot of progress and learn from others.
I think that's great, and certainly I think for climate change science, which is obviously what we've been talking about in these series, that international collaboration has just got better and better, particularly in how we're, you know, looking at climate change impacts and addressing climate change. So I think that is definitely a positive story, and how we're internationally able to come together and make share knowledge and make a difference. So that's fantastic to hear. You picked up a little bit there about seagrass restoration, which I know is now happening much more in Scotland, and maybe pushing the way forward here a little bit on this. You said earlier that a lot of conservation in the marine environment is about reducing pressures rather than restoration. Of course, we see conversations about restoration and rewilding in terrestrial environments maybe much more than we do in the marine environment. I wondered why we don't talk about restoration more in the marine environment. Is that because it's difficult, or it's less useful, or what's the kind of underlying reasons behind that?
Yeah, I think, well, if you look at the two things that people are most interested in restoring at the moment, and where most progress has been made, it's on native oysters and on seagrasses. Those are two species which you're going to find in very shallow coastal fringe waters. Yeah. So there's actually a practicality element of doing that work. And certainly with a lot of the work coming from, there's a whole range of different groups involved, but certainly for the work that's led by communities, if they've got work that can happen in shallow waters, that makes it easier for a wider range of people to get involved, and also to see the results and to see what's happening from all of that. So I think that's part of the element of it. I think marine restoration work is expensive to do as well, so that's the limiting factor. And I think if we were to try and move marine restoration work a lot further beyond kind of 10 meter water depths that the seagrass kind of stuff is working at, the expense of it would ratchet up quite considerably. And so I think that will always be a limiting factor. And I also think when we talk about marine habitats, some marine habitats that we've got are just really, really extensive. So the mud habitats and the kelp forests that I referred to before. And I'm not sure whether actually having a conversation about creating more of those habitats is necessarily what we want to do. We want to make sure that the habitats we already have are in a good condition and functioning properly. So I guess that's why, having those habitats as covering such huge areas having them function well is a really good way of actually focusing our kind of, what are relatively limited resources for the kind of wider programme of marine conservation work. So, I mean, and I guess there are other countries that are doing other types of restoration work. So there are other countries in Japan, they've been doing work on kelp restoration and things like that. But I guess I've never felt that kelp was sort of limited in that way. If you stand on the beach in Scotland and look, you're bound to see, lots of areas that are kind of look through the water as quite brown with large plants there. It doesn't feel as if a restoration effort on species like that is a really, again, where we're going to get the most benefit.
I was talking to someone about marine conservation earlier, and we had the conversation that perhaps, you know, it felt like marine conservation was behind that of terrestrial environment originally, and yet even in the last 10-20 years, perhaps terrestrial conservation could take some lessons from what's happening in the marine environment in terms of protection rather than restoration, in terms of that connectivity you were mentioning earlier. So it might be marine conservation shooting ahead to a certain degree, in making these inroads into what is actually going to be of greater value. So that's interesting to hear your take on that.
Yeah, and I think it's something about having the, as marine conservation has developed, having the confidence really to do things differently and not to sort of worry about whether you're behind. The marine environment is just different, and the approaches that are being developed now are different, and I think are suitable for what we want to achieve for Scotland Seas.
Well, I think that was a kind of a nice point to end the conversation on. We're running out of time, but I do have one last question that's come in actually a couple of times in various formats, and I'm throwing this at you, so I'm sorry if it's a difficult one at the end, but some people were asking, I think at the beginning you mentioned conscious consumerism, and it's the kind of question that always comes up at these events. We're wondering, is there a change you've made in how you exist on the planet as a consumer or as a person, that comes from your job and your knowledge, that perhaps you would, I don't know, recommend to other people, or that you feel has made a difference to you, as a kind of final note to end on?
Yeah, I'm not, what becomes hard to distinguish when you do something for a long time is what's come from your job and what's come from your kind of wider thinking. I guess over the last year and a half, I've been reflecting on a lot of things, and at the moment, I guess at a personal level, it feels about thinking about those small changes that you can make to your everyday life that collectively then adds up to much greater sum of the parts. So yeah, it's just things like, you know, having the ability to not use your car so much, to walk into various different places, to really think about whether you need to buy all the things that you were buying previously when you probably didn't need to buy them. And I guess thinking, again, this is not a kind of NatureScot policy perspective, but actually, you know, when you want to have something and you need it, thinking about the kind of quality of it and where it's come from, how it's been produced, and you know, buying something that's really going to last for the purpose that you need it for. So yeah, it's not influenced particularly by marine thinking, but just kind of by a general approach to life. But yeah, were there other things that were coming out from your conversations recently on that side of things?
No, I don't think so. I think what people have been saying is that it just feels like there's a lot of swaps happening, a lot of people just very consciously making these choices. And I think people are doing that more and more. And it's nice to hear from people at your level and in your position that actually that's just a thing that's happening over time. And, you know, you're not perfect. No one's perfect in this. There's maybe a collective guilt around it, but there is also a collective possibility to just be better every day and every week. So, yeah, I think that's great. I think we're bang on time, and I'm sad to have to end the conversation, but I will end it there if that's okay. And just say huge, huge thank you to Katie for coming and giving us a great talk and a really interesting discussion. I would love to have continued it, but maybe next year we can do a longer event. And thank you to everyone that's joined us this evening as well at this event. Do remember to share the talk when it's online. We will send the email around to everybody if you enjoyed this, like other people to watch it. You can also sign up to the mailing list. I put that in the chat, or follow us on Twitter. We're using the hashtag SeaTember, or we're at SAGES or Masts. We do have another talk next Wednesday, which is by Martin Hurst, University of Glasgow, who will be talking about a dynamic coast project that Katie mentioned. So it's a perfect follow-on from this if you enjoyed this. If you have any further questions, please do get in touch and we will try and answer them if we didn't get to it. I think I got to most people's questions. And thank you for your engagement and attentivity. Just made up a word at the end there, and attentiveness during this entire session. So thank you very much. Enjoy the rest of your evening, and huge thanks to Katie again.
Thanks very much, Hannah.
Okay. Bye, everyone.